Welcome to another edition of County Connection. I'm your host, Berks County Commissioner Christian Leinbach. Our topic on today's show is a look at the countywide public safety radio system. Not too many years ago, we had a radio system that, well, it really wasn't a system. It was a patched together various group of radio systems, fire, police, etc. We have a number of guests on our program this evening. First of all, we have our Berks County Department of Emergency Services Director, Brian Gottschall. Brian, thank you for being here. And we have the president of the Berks County Chief of Police Association, Chief Erik Grinzig. Good to have you. We also have Colin Hackman. He's the chairperson of the Berks County Fire Working Group. Welcome, Colin. And we also have with us Tony Tucci, chairperson of the Berks County EMS Working Group. Tony, welcome.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
We want to start by going back and talking a little bit about the history. We'll start with you, Brian. A number of years ago, actually a number, 11 years ago, when I took office, one of the very first things I saw in January of 2008 was a huge study on the need for a new county radio system. What were the driving issues back then that led to the need of a countywide, new countywide radio system?
Yeah, you're correct, Commissioner. This discussion had been underway, as you point out, even prior to the current board assuming office about 11 years ago. And there had even been extensive work done in the last 3 years of the prior board, looking at the system as it stood in the county at that point in time, recognizing the problems. The number one problem that I think everyone recognized was coverage issues, where our emergency responders did not have adequate radio coverage to be able to talk back to the 911 center or to each other unless they were very close to each other. We also had capacity issues. We just didn't have enough channels, enough places for people to go to be able to talk. We had severe interoperability issues where we didn't have our own emergency services providers able to talk to each other, meaning across disciplines, let alone with neighboring counties. And at that time, even the city of Reading itself was an island in the middle of the county on its own standalone radio system. And all of this kind of got rolled together by the federal government in what was called a narrowbanding mandate, which was a technical change that needed to be made to our radio systems to stay compliant with federal law. And that narrowbanding mandate really, although it was ultimately a minor piece of what we had to solve, it was the time driver that somewhat forced this Board of Commissioners to do what prior boards had not been prepared to do, which was take the dive and move forward into something more modern and more appropriate to serve our emergency services into this century.
And this is all about first responders and their ability to communicate not just with the 911 center, but communicate with each other. Chief Hackman, talk a little bit about your experience prior to the new system. What were some of the challenges that you faced?
Prior to the new system, I would say 3/4 of the county was on one frequency, which was a low band frequency, and the western central part of the county, the last quarter of the county was on a high band frequency. The high band frequency worked pretty well. We had ops channels, but it was very difficult to communicate with the companies that were on the low band. If we would go out for mutual aid, they would be coming in to assist us.
And you were in the fire service, in-building communications were almost impossible.
That's correct. Very poor at best.
So from the fire service to police, Chief Grinzig, what are some of your recollections of issues that police had with the old radio system?
Well, I think we're all pretty much similar in some of the circumstances that we had. My municipality, just the topography of it, there were spots that we couldn't talk to neighboring departments, even on the county frequency. There were times we'd have calls inside of residents in some of the more rural areas of the township, mountainous mm-hmm. areas, where a car could be on the same road with an officer inside the residence and they couldn't talk to each other. Add the issue of my department in Muhlenberg borders the city of Reading, and we couldn't talk to the city of Reading police. So, you know, fortunately, a lot of that has been rectified. And just some of the coverages inside some of the buildings, like the mall I have, although there's not many businesses left inside the mall, there's areas that
Fairgrounds mall
historically would be very, very problematic to get communications out. And the system now, as it stands, it's just 1,000 times better.
Right. Tony, EMS, ambulance service, what kind of issues did you face? Similar, I'm sure.
Very similar to everyone else. I mean, communications back and forth between providers, but some of them, you couldn't hear providers calling into the comm center to get information, and you'd be stepping on one another left and right because we couldn't hear. With the new system, we're able to hear everybody. So it works out very well.
So let's talk about that briefly. And I remember hearing about that. You were stepping on each other. You didn't know it. But what impact did it have on communications back at the comm center?
Yeah, so the cause of that was the fact that we had this high power radio on a mountaintop that we were talking out to everybody, but the units talking into us were talking in on fairly low powered radios, and they would key up and believe they had clear air, and then another unit on some other location would key up, not being able to hear them directly, think that they had clear air, and now we have two people talking to us at one time, stepping all over each other, and both parties' messages are indecipherable.
And really, at the end of the day, this is a communications tool. And if you don't have clear communications, we put people at risk. We put our own people at risk. We put the folks that we're trying to protect, in the case of police, people that we're trying to rescue, people that we're trying to either get to their location or take them to the hospital. Communication is key. One of the other serious problems, and we didn't really talk about it much at the time, there were several single points of failure that could have taken the entire system down potentially for indefinite periods.
Absolutely. We were very concerned. And at the time that we were presenting to the public our justification for the new radio system, we of course wanted to be as transparent as possible, but we also didn't want to reveal any what we considered to be obvious vulnerabilities that someone could use to exploit. And after the fact now, it's kind of a little bit more comfortable to talk about those things and acknowledge them. And one of them is the reality that the vast majority of our county was serviced by a single shack and tower on top of Mount Penn. The reality is that a Molotov cocktail thrown over the wall, thrown over the fence outside of that tower site at the appropriate place in the building where the radio antenna lines came out of the building could have wiped out our police, fire, and EMS radio coverage for a vast majority of the county.
And for a fairly long period of time. I remember us talking about that and you saying, Commissioner, we really need to move on this, because it wasn't an easy decision.
No.
You become a new county commissioner, and two of us came in January of 2008, Commissioner Barnhart and myself, and we were faced with a $55 million project, and we said, well, what other options have been looked at? And there were some real questions about the study. We don't really have time to get into them, other than to say, if we had moved ahead with the original recommendations, we would have had a serious problem. Coverage would have been one of the issues, because we didn't look, or the prior boards didn't look at in-building versus outside of building coverage. We didn't look at the tower locations. But the big issue on the new system is the interconnectivity of the towers. And before we get to that, let's touch on the ultimate price tag and rough timeline of the new radio project.
Yeah, so we went under contract in December of 2010 after an RFP process that took the better part of a year to complete. We had multiple vendors competing for this contract, ultimately elected in December of 2010 to contract with Motorola Solutions. And the price tag becomes very hazy, and I feel like whenever I explain this to people that they think I'm lying to them or trying to cover things up. It's just that it is very complicated. So the cost to Motorola for the infrastructure of the radio system was about $26 million. The cost to all of our end user agencies for their walkie-talkies and in-vehicle radios that they use was about $13 million. And then the cost of the physical plant construction, the actual tower sites and shacks and the fences that go around them and all of that related installation was about $18 million. So the price tag of the whole system, when you rolled everything up, came out to the better part of $64 million. As you well know, a significant investment at the time, the second most expensive project of county government, superseded only by the services center construction and courthouse renovation.
So we did it. We went through the process. We worked with our fire companies, our police departments, EMS, our municipalities, and the system was implemented. And I think it's time to ask the question, how are we doing? And I made a list, the issues that led to the need for a new system were coverage or the lack thereof, the capacity, channel capacity, communication capacity, interoperability between various departments and various services, the narrowbanding mandate, we don't really need to discuss that, we met that mandate, and then resiliency and the single point of failure issue and how we address that. So why don't we start with the system that was put into place? I know you have an image here and can talk a little bit about how resilient the system is. And then I'd like to hear from the rest of our guests and talk about some specific experiences you've had that have addressed the coverage issue, the capacity issue, interoperability, and the like.
Sure. We can go to our first graphic if you'd like. This is a graphic out of our SCADA system, our supervisory control and data acquisition system. It's in essence the system that we use to monitor the overall health of the radios. And this shows all of the various installations throughout the county, whether they're transmitter sites or specific points of operation like the county 911 center and dispatch center, the city hall dispatch center that's used to dispatch city police. And as you can see, we've highly diversified the system among these various locations. And what that means for us is that even though any one of these locations, it's certainly possible it can go down. It could lose power and then the generator could fail. We could have an extended power outage in a mountaintop site where we run out of fuel in the generators because we can't get there in the number of days because of heavy snowfall or something like that to refuel it. Theoretically, a windstorm could blow a tower down, although that's highly unlikely. It's
especially after the recent windstorm we had.
Yeah, well, and much more likely that we would lose, for example, a microwave dish or an antenna off the tower. But all these green pins, as I said, represent the points of presence in the radio system, and the gray lines are microwave connections between those places. And that's one of the huge things about this system that we didn't have previously. Previously, we relied on telephone lines, infrastructure that was in the ground or hanging on telephone poles to connect our radio sites that we did have back to the county. Now everything is done through the air on our own infrastructure. It all you can kind of see from the graphic that it's interconnected loops. So even if something does go down, the traffic is kind of sent in the other direction. And this has really helped us to resolve our resiliency and single point of failure issues.
And we have gotten tremendous feedback from all of the users, but who would like to jump in, give us an example of the difference you've seen? Chief?
Sure. Just with some of the traffic we were talking about, the legacy system that we were on before, we were dealing with primarily most of the police departments being dispatched on one main channel frequency, and you had a second frequency dealing with registrations and things that we were doing, you know, off-site. There was another frequency where there was some departments down Boyertown area, some of the other areas that were on that channel. And my department's a busy department, so you could have issues where, again, we don't want to step on other agencies or someone else talking. So the radio traffic by them, but moving the new system and having the other channels available, it kind of split the county. There's not any issues of where you have the heavy traffic.
And you have the capacity to move people into different channels that we really didn't have those options before.
Correct. And in a case of emergency, we may still tie up some of the frequency initially until we can get moved to another operations channel to try to free up that main dispatch, that frequency.
So from a policing standpoint, definite improvement. Chief Hackman, from a fire side.
100% improvement. We can pretty much talk from one end of the county to the other on a portable radio and hear what's going on. We don't have to worry about two different frequencies that we're going off of. Everybody's on the same radio system. So it's just a matter of flipping a switch to be able to talk to maybe somebody else. Plus there's more operation channels that if they're working an incident, they can switch over to that to get off of the main talk groups to allow other priority traffic to handle.
EMS.
I think from the EMS standpoint, it came out as we can now talk with the city of Reading. If we're dispatched in Western Berks as one of the primary services that goes into the city, we're able to communicate with the city units very easily and very clearly. Before, we didn't have that capability. So that's probably one of the best things for us, the interoperability of services between EMS.
Go ahead. I think equally important is some of the functionality of the system that isn't really big picture, like coverage or capacity, mm-hmm. something countywide, but just functionality of an enterprise radio system. We now have what we call the orange button. It's an emergency button on everybody's radio. And if a public safety officer is in duress, they're in a scuffle with a patient who's out of control or a subject that they're taking into custody, or even a firefighter who becomes trapped in a building collapse or something like that, they can hit this button and immediately send a notification through tones to everybody on the channel that they're in duress. It tells the communication center there's a certain procedure that's followed. That individual is given prioritization on that channel. Just really some behind-the-scenes functionality that makes things much safer for our public safety officers.
Well, and I think that's a very good point. It's not just that we have a new system, that we have new technology, but there is a process that has to be followed in order for this to work. And I know that when we made the transition, in preparation for that transition, getting that process in place and getting all the end users acclimated took some time, but it's absolutely worth it because at the end, that helps to save lives. And from an interoperability, several of you have talked about that. But now there's very clear communication, not just in your department, but among different working groups. You police talking to fire, fire talking to EMS. And one of the other things, talk a little bit about the ability to create talk groups for unique situations. I know we've done that with some events, for instance.
Yeah, I think a couple of the guys referred to operations talk groups. And I think that's what you're alluding to. We have certain, people would call them channels, but they're really called talk groups in a trunk radio system that are reserved for specific ongoing operations, whether it be a working structure fire, whether it be a police searching a wooded area for a subject, or EMS in a mass casualty incident. And we can now take those incidents and move them over onto their own radio communications talk pass so that all of the people, no matter what uniform they wear, what department they're from, what discipline they serve, can be working together and talking on that same talk path. And equally important, freeing up the day in and day out channel that is used for ongoing communication so that we can continue to do the important work that's going on in the whole rest of the county while that incident's underway.
So real quickly, I'm going to put you on the spot. I didn't prep you for this, but on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being absolute failure, 10 being absolute perfection, where would you put the new county radio system? I'll go to our chief of police first.
I'd say 9.9.
9.9. I'd
take
that as
anything perfect.
Pretty high. Nothing's perfect. Yeah. And that's why I said, to me, 10's hard to attain. Chief Hackman.
I'd say 8.5, 9.
Okay.
I want to say the same with the chief, 8.5, 9. I think we still have some extra steps we need to go to. Some of the things that Brian is putting forth together, going to you with the GPS location.
Yep.
I think that's going to be a great next step tool, and that's going to post it up even more.
Absolutely.
Well, let's talk about those next steps. I should mention, we do know there's the Albany Hole up around the Hawk Mountain, Kempton area. We knew that going in. Very, very difficult to site a tower. We continue to work with Albany Township. Kempton Fire Company has been great in the way they have worked with us and understanding the limitations. So we're aware of that. But let's go to the GPS. That's something that our Board of Commissioners should be approving in the next 30 plus days.
Yep, we're very close to finalizing the engineering on that with Motorola. The ball is really in their court to get us the final answers. We found that we tend to ask more questions than some of their customers might ask before they're willing to sign on the dotted line, and I think that's good. I think that's in our best interest.
I think it's very good.
It frustrates them a little bit, and it makes the process go a little longer, but we feel more confident.
But the bottom line is, each of you guys in the field and the people that work on your teams, the men and women, they like this, because it means they can be found via their radio.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Another step is the completion of the Mount Penn Tower rebuild, and that should be completed this summer?
Yeah, we have a graphic for that. That actually shows our old site at Mount Penn and what we were dealing with, you know, cinder block buildings with wooden roofs and Amish sheds at the base of rusty old towers. We're rehabbing this site and getting it back up to the condition of our new site so that it's going to continue to serve us for many years also.
Yeah, that was one of the existing towers. A couple of other things, we're going to be refleeting all 5,100 radios in the system over the next 90 to 120 days. Very quickly, what's involved with that?
As generous as the Chiefs were in pointing out our successes, we don't ever do anything perfect, and we have 3 years of experience under our belt collectively. We've worked with the working groups of the various disciplines, and we're now going to basically be reprogramming all of the 5,100 radios in possession of all of the services that use the system to ensure that they're modified to a new operational vision, the best functionality, the best firmware that we can get from Motorola.
And that shows a major commitment on the part of the county to our end users. We don't just want to give them a radio and then say you're on your own. It was important to us to be able to upgrade the technology. It's one of the reasons we mandated everybody has to use a Motorola radio. The last area that we are just getting ready to upgrade is the pager system. It is not the radio, it's a tool, and we're looking very quickly in the last minute that we have, we're looking at an update over the next several months. What is that all about?
So a new product has come to market that allows primarily our fire and our fire and EMS personnel to carry a single device on their hip that allows them to hear both the paging channel that they're activated on as well as the 700 radio system. The commissioners, recognizing the importance that this technology brings, has offered out the ability of these end user agencies to finance these purchases at 0% interest over 3 years. So we're just in the process of putting that program together and going to have it rolled out very soon.
Well, I hope you stay tuned and watch the news, watch this show. We'll give you an update, hopefully, at the latter part of this year. But this is a special show that talks about why we did what we did with the county radio system. And $64 million later, you heard it here from the men and the women that are using the system. An 8.8 to a 9.9 rating on the success of the system, and we're committed to making it even better. Thank you for joining us on another edition of County Connection. I'm your host, County Commissioner Christian Leinbach, looking forward to seeing you the next time on County Connection.